Hi, I'm Robin Harden, and this is Dreamcatcher, the program where you can find peace through understanding, dreams, and visions. On today's program, you'll see how the Lord talks to us through different types of dreams. Tiffany's dream consists mainly of realistic scenes pertaining to her life, but Renee's dream has many scenes that aren't really realistic, and yet both dreams are messages from the Lord.
Hey Robin, I had a dream, and in my dream, like the background was that the country was just in total chaos. The environment was being threatened, habitat for loss was happening, species were threatened, and the discrepancy between the rich and the poor was greater than it had ever been. Children were being victimized, and truth was being suppressed. I don't know if I said that already. In the dream, I was in this carnival, and there was some little ride with preschool students, preschool-aged children. And it was like a shallow pond with little boats, and there were toys, and all the children were each in their own little boat with their own little toy. But when the ride was over, this one little boy must have fallen out because he wasn't in his boat anymore. He was standing in the water, and he was frightened, and his toy had floated away to another part of the pond. And I went in to get him and rescue him. And when I started to go in to get him, the young man who was running the ride said to me, you're not allowed in there. You're not allowed to go into the water. And I said, then I suggest you turn your head and look the other way because I'm going to go get that little kid. And so he looked, you know, I guess he looked away. I don't know. I didn't pay attention to him after that. But I went in and I got the child and brought him out of the water and I got his toy and carried him out of the water and, you know, got him out safely. And then the dream shifts. And that's the only part of the dream that I'm in. It's just that very first part. After this, I'm no longer in the dream. I'm just kind of seeing what's going on. The next part of the dream, there's a young woman who's a reporter. And somehow in the dream, I know that she represents truth. And some reason there's this water and it's very pure and it's very sacred and she has to retrieve this water, and so she goes through all sorts of obstacles and retrieves a glass of this water, and then there's this long journey, and again there's many obstacles, many things getting in the way and making it difficult, but she just travails and gets through it all and just doesn't give up and keeps going. And finally, she comes like to these set of really tall, like concrete or stone steps. But meanwhile, there's like three things going on at the same time. While she's getting the water and making her journey, there's a very old man with a cane who is struggling just to walk. He's all bent over with a cane. And he's making a journey of his own. And he's also facing tons of obstacles and having all kinds of difficulties. But he's determined, and he keeps coming, and he keeps, you know, he's not going to give up. And then the third part, there's this tiny little sea turtle, which is making its own journey. So all three are making journeys, and all three are facing just tremendous obstacles and problems that are interfering, you know, making it hard for them to get to where they're going. But all three are very determined and keep coming. Finally, at some point, the turtle climbs up on the woman. It's like on her shoulder. And then she comes to this set of the stone steps. And it's like they go on forever. And she's climbing up these stone steps. And she's got the glass of water and she's got the turtle. And it's like she's really, really tired by this point, but she keeps going. And the old man, at the same time, is traversing his own set of matching stone steps, just like hers. And he's just beat because he's, you know, looks like he's 100. And walking is difficult, let alone climbing all these steps. But he does it anyway, and he keeps going no matter how tired he gets. And then it turns out that they're on opposite sides of the same. The steps come on opposite sides, and there's a big platform on the top. And they meet, at the top of the steps on this platform, and by this point, the woman has actually drank the water that was in the glass. She no longer has the glass, but she's drank the water, and the droplets of water on her lips. And in the dream, I somehow know that the water represents, like, the Holy Spirit and represents life and spirit. And they meet in the middle of the platform, and they kiss, but it's an innocent, very innocent kiss, like a parent and a child would do, like a mother and child kiss. And when they kiss, the droplets transfer from her lips to the old man's lips, and the turtle crawls from her shoulder onto the old man, and the three of them are united there on top of this platform. And then the dream shifts yet again. The next part of the dream, there are many, many children. Young, like preschool through elementary age children, all different races, all different, you know, colors, blondes, black hair, blue eyes, brown eyes, all different skin types and colors, and, you know, just the most diverse group of children you can imagine. And they were all going to get these tickets. And so they finally all get their tickets, and then they're running throughout the city, and they're just gleeful and happy, and they're running through the city, and they're tossing these tickets everywhere. And it turns out the tickets turn out to be money, like bills, dollar bills. They might have been $100 bills, I don't know, but they were bills. And the last scene, and the children are laughing as they're throwing out the tickets, and the last scene of the dream, there's a fountain, like a city fountain, a round city fountain with a stone wall around it where you could sit with the fountain, you know, flowing up in the middle. And there's a big stack of these bills on the seat of the fountain, and the wind is catching the bills and carrying them off and dispersing them about the city. And the wind in the dream, I know, is the Holy Spirit, and is dispersing the money throughout the city that the children have distributed. That was the end of the dream. But when I went to bed that night, I went to bed praying for our country and all that's going on in this country right now. And I've been praying for the country a lot. But when I woke up, the first thing that came to mind was the scripture, and a little child shall lead them. And I just woke up just at peace and with just great, just sense of joy. And it's like God was telling me, you know, the country's a mess right now. There's a lot going on. But it's all going to come out right in the end. The turtle represented creation, the environment. The woman represented truth. The old man and the children represent the least of these. And in the dream, I was only played one small part at the very beginning. And I only rescued one child. But that's all it, you know, each one of us, you know, is like we have our own part to play. And in the big scheme of things, it might not seem like much, you know, just one children out of all the children in the country, or the world for that matter. But if we all do our part, then it's like when we all do our part, it's all going to come together. And also in the dream, everybody, the woman, the turtle, the old man, they all faced, you know, really severe obstacles and things that would stop them. And there are people that would tell us not to do the right thing. Like, I wasn't allowed in the pool to rescue the little boy, but I did it anyway. And so the dream was telling me, you know, that if we all do what's right and ignore the people telling us that we can't or we shouldn't or whatever, we all do what we know God wants us to, and we all do our part, even though it may not seem like much, and if we don't give up and we keep, what was it Paul said about continuing the race, you know, to the end. The other thing was that the child's toy represented his gift. So when I rescued him and I got his toy, I actually rescued the child, and along with his gift, his spiritual gift.
I love it when you send me dreams and you know the interpretation. Now, Renee's my sister, so you probably think, well, it runs in your family. It can run in your family too. God is speaking to you, and He wants you to know what He's saying. some of the symbols that she shared with you. You can know that by reading your word. The water in the Bible is the Holy Spirit. Wind in the Bible is the Holy Spirit. So in a dream, these elements represent Holy Spirit. Renee is absolutely right on with the interpretation of this dream. And the message, the big message, just pinpointing it, is do the right thing, even when people tell you not to. There are going to be times, and as a matter of fact, there are already times, when we must do what is right, stepping out in our authority, even when people don't want us to. We have to make the right decisions. I love how in the dream, everyone is on their own journey. Creation is the little turtle trying to make it. The elderly man, he is, like she said, the least of these, the little children who are innocent, who can't do for themselves and make their own choices. She already told you the background is a horrible. There's a big divide between the haves and the have-nots. The Lord is showing us that unless believers come together in unity with truth, not with a denomination, not with a political party, but with the truth of God's word, we can change this. And you know, this dream is very much about a two-party civilization that we're in. We've got people coming up from one side, we've got the lady coming up from the other side of these platforms, but we meet in the middle. I know it's hard to believe, if you're a Republican, that there are Democrats who love the Lord. And it's also just as hard to believe, as a Democrat, that there are Republicans that are really doing God's work. That is the enemy doing that to us. God is not Republican, and God is not a Democrat. God is sovereign. He's the leader of the host of the armies. He wants us to come together. And I believe, for the most part, the majority of Americans on both parties want the same results. We just have different ways of getting there. Both parties want a beautiful earth. We don't want pollution. We want our animals to stop going extinct. We want there to be less poverty. We just have different ideas on how to get there. And this is where Holy Spirit comes in. We need to listen to His guidance and His instruction. And this also speaks to this coronavirus as well. Because people are not in churches as frequently as they once were, and because people aren't working, and because many children aren't even in school full-time, they're doing virtual schools or they're doing some kind of combination, we are going to see a greater divide between the haves and the have-nots unless something is done. I'm fortunate enough that I'm going to be able to be the virtual coach for my granddaughter so she doesn't miss out. But what about parents who have to work, who have elementary school children, and they can't afford a teacher? They can't afford a tutor. They have the choice of sending their children to school where there's a virus or leaving them home by themselves. And even older children, they're being left at home to learn. The rich people are going to hire tutors. They're going to have nannies. They're going to have people who can help train their children and teach their children, while the poorer parents are going to see their children fall further and further behind. As believers, as Republicans, as Democrats, as people, it is our job to do the right thing and help put these children back into their boats, help these children to learn, turn these children toward the Lord. We've got to do this together, or we're going to see the first part of her dream become a reality. But God promises that if we will humble ourselves and pray and seek His face and turn from our wicked ways, He will heal this land. And that means from this plague, this virus, but it also means from the divide, the hatred, the riots, the prejudice. God is the answer. Truth is the answer. And that kiss at the top of the platform, that's how we do this. That's love. That is simply transferring the love of the Holy Spirit of Jesus to one another. Thank you, Renee, for sharing this. Thank you for your interpretation as well. I hope this shows you first that we need to pray and we can defeat this, but also that you can learn what it is the Lord is saying to you.
Walking, Talking, Debating, and Arguing with God is a lighthearted collection of short stories depicting some of Robin's real-life experiences and testimonies. You'll laugh and cry as Robin shares her plight of being the new kid year after year. Take a trip along Robin's spiritual journey, which she describes as straight and narrow and straight up the side of a mountain.
Catch it. Catch what, you ask? Good question. Catch a dream. The dream that God has for you to manifest His will in your life. And sometimes that's not pleasant. But remember, in a one-night dream can change the rest of your life and those that are around you. Remember, Joseph's dream was for them, not for him. We are here to help you catch the dream God has for you. Catch your dream.
Hi, I'm Pastor Brent from Fairview Church, and our church was so excited to adopt the month of December with Joseph's Storehouse. We want to thank you guys, and we want to wish you all.
Joseph's Storehouse provides nourishment of body and soul to families in need.
Well, they helped me a whole lot, helped me with my groceries. I'm proud to be here.
Each month, churches, businesses, and people just like you adopt a month to help distribute food and God's Word to hundreds of hungry families.
My dad was the pastor, or more like the overseer, of a very large church. The church was huge in size, but it was an older structure, but still very much so intact. There was a big event being held there. I think it involved the AME Church, which is the denomination that he is a pastor for. And it was going to involve a lot of, the program that was being held there was going to involve a lot of pomp and circumstance. A bunch of important people were coming to the church. But my dad was very nonchalant about it, which is opposite of how he usually is. So he was very carefree. And there was a lady there, and her name, I'll call her Miss Carol. She was going to be singing at the program. Now, this lady, Miss Carol, So this lady, Miss Carol, so come out of the dream for a second.
Okay.
The church where my dad currently is, she was the pastor's wife previously.
Okay.
And they are not at that church anymore because they got elected, her husband got elected to a higher position.
Okay.
All right. So she was coming back to the church to sing. All right. So she came to me and she asked me where the circuit breaker was. She said that she looked for it, but she couldn't find it. Or she said she did find what she thought was the circuit breaker because she went where she used to go when she was at the church in the basement. But she said when she flipped the switch, it didn't do what she expected it to do. And she said she needed the circuit breaker switched because she needed some music sheets delivered from the music store for the song that she was going to sing the next day. So I remember thinking to her, I don't know if this is a good idea because if she cuts off the circuit breaker, it's gonna affect more than one room. This church is a bit old. I don't know if we'll be able to get the lights to turn back on, but whatever. Now, and in the dream, her personality was also very opposite of what it usually is. She was very docile to me, very like a slave is to a master. Like she was holding her head down and like I was above her and she was beneath me. So I told her that she wasn't sure. I told her I wasn't sure about the circuit breaker, but she would need to ask my dad. We're still in the dream. I then went to sleep. And then I woke up. And in the dream, the bed that I slept in was my husband, my current bed that I sleep in every day. And when I woke up, a nurse was bringing me and my husband our baby, our newborn baby. And I remember thinking, bring me this baby, because I haven't seen this baby since I gave birth. I don't know when I gave birth, but I went to sleep, woke up, and she was bringing me a baby. The baby was cute, and it was a little boy. I looked at his face, and then his face changed to an adult face, adult man face. And we were going to take those newborn pictures where the little babies, you know, like that. And I went to the bathroom because I wanted to put on some makeup before the pictures so that I would look nice. But I realized that I didn't have my makeup because I was not at my own house. I was either at my parents' house or at their church. So I just put on my mom's makeup and I was like, you know, this'll work. I'll just make it work. And then the lady Carol, who was going to sing, she asked my dad very humbly, you know, where the circuit breaker was. I don't remember what he told her. And then the service began, and I remember being very surprised because the important people began to, well, important in their eyes, they began to process down the aisle of the church because the program was beginning. But I was very surprised because my dad was not in the processional with them. He was just like in charge, overseeing things, telling people what to do. But my dad did not seem concerned at all. And I had a really good seat on the second row in like the VIP section because of who my dad was. And that's all I remember.
This is a great dream. I really love this dream, especially for your dad. He is in a, what is, you know, a traditional church, a traditional congregation, a denomination. And we know that because the church is old, and we know that because it's been around forever. But the beautiful thing is he's still the pastor in it, and he's not hung up on the traditions of man. He's not, I mean, he's showing the respect, but he's not overly indulging in all the, you know, the pomp and circumstance. He knows why he's there, for real. And the people who are even above him are humbling themselves before him, and because the Lord is going to promote him because of this new revelation that he has, this new, maybe not even revelation, but just that new, deeper understanding of the Lord. You walk with him forever, you know, all his life, and then all of a sudden the Lord reveals something new about himself, and it's going to really promote your father to spiritually to where people that he may even consider spiritual leaders will recognize it in him and be humbled before him. When someone shows up in a dream, it may not be Miss Carol, but she represents someone that has gone before him, someone, you know, of a high spiritual level. She wanted to find a circuit breaker to get paper lyrics of songs sent to her. That's showing that, you know, we're living in a new age now, and like just this Zoom thing we're trying to do, and we're talking some of us older people into how to do this. That's kind of what was going on with her. She's trying to continue, she's trying to come back into his place where he is in charge of, and trying to do things the way we used to. You know, the people say, well, we used to do, and your father realizes that way is not the way now. The way is, there's a new way of doing it. And your father has, there's a new freedom about him that he knows that's, he doesn't need to do that. And then the nurse bringing you the baby, God has already birthed something in you, and you haven't seen it yet, but it's already happened, and you're about to see that. And because your husband, and because you're in the bed and you're asleep, and falling asleep and waking up in a dream is revelation. It's something, you know, he's opened your eyes to you. But because it implies you and your husband there together, I would venture to say there's a very good possibility that the reason you hadn't seen whatever this new thing is he's birthed in you is the Lord was waiting for you to get married for this new thing to happen. So it's something that's already in your spirit and you're about to see it, and it's something to do with prophetic, because baby boys typically represent the prophetic in a dream. And so, and I think it's connected with the teachings and the word that you grew as a child. That's why it's kind of connected with your dad's church. But it's, I just get a real, just kind of a joy thinking about your father, and like a new freedom is what I keep hearing, like a liberate him, so he can take this church, even though he's not one of the young pastors, he can take this church into the next season like a young pastor would. And you may even have something to do with that, since you, it's all part of the same dream. But I'm anxious to see what that is that he's already birthed that you're going to see. And of course he's cute. He said he was cute. It's like, of course he is.
Why would his face turn into a little adult? Oh,
because that is the wisdom beyond his years. God's going to, whatever this is, it's already been birthed. Because it's already there, it's going to advance quickly. Once you see it, it's going to, and maybe it's just a matter of you going, oh, that's what it was. Once you get there, it's going to advance quickly. You're going to see it succeed fast.
Okay.
So that's exciting. Yay.
Dreamcatcher Journal. It's geared to help you catch your dreams with over 50 scriptures, inspirational words, and revelations, all pointing to dreams and dream interpretation.
I have one of your books and I love it.
Straight from the Bible, over 90 symbols that you can compare your dreams with and find the scripture that might help you interpret your dream.
Find out what it is the Lord is saying to you. Get Dreamcatcher Journal to help catch your dreams.
God is a God of unity. It's the devil that tries to divide us. We must make the right decisions even when it's unpopular. As believers, we have the answer, and it's up to us to share the love of God in every situation. Catch us here next time on Dreamcatcher, and catch your dreams.
People see you. Yes. They see you for the problem or the thing that you have done, but God sees you differently.
Jesus, he is God. He is good. He is Jesus.
Join Pastor Johann at Love's Way Church Sunday morning at 10 a.m. and Wednesday evening at 6:30 p.m.